Good Yuntiv. So even though services used to start at 8 o'clock, that doesn't mean you have 30 minutes of schmoozing or cocktail hour, anything like that. Of course, it also doesn't mean that the Cantor and the Rabbi won't do 30 more minutes of stuff either, just saying. Why don't you have a seat so we can begin our service? We obviously come here with a heavy heart as we think about Puerto Rico and Mexico and what they're going through at this very moment. So I invite us to take a deep breath in. Breathing in that sense of Lishana Tova, a new year, and exhaling out. You know what you need to exhale out. We begin on page 7 in our Machzor. Summer's gone, night grows cold. These are the days of awe, the shofar blows. With bread in hand down to the sea, we take time, give thanks, and cast our sadness free. That we may start fresh, that we may come clear, that we may know sweetness and peace throughout the year, that we may find love where we need it most, and open our hearts and hands and draw each other close. A day to fast and count the ways, we've promised and fallen short, we meet each other's gaze. Begin again, life won't wait, time turns and we return and walk on through the gates. Under the moon, a roof of trees, we bring in the harvest beneath the stars we eat and sing for joy, make ourselves strong. We'll reap what we've sown, may it last all year long. That we may start fresh, that we may come clear, that we may know sweetness and peace throughout the year, that we may find love where we need it most and open our hearts and hands and draw each other close. We continue with Esayinai that you can find in the handout, number 1.
Thank you.
One of my favorite minhagim, or rituals that we've started, is that every year for Rosh Hashanah, those that light the candles are the volunteer of the year, or the volunteers of the year. This year's no exceptions. We have two amazing people, Dan Lee and Deborah Zimmer, both of which have done so much for the synagogue. Dan Lee being a past president, very involved with so many important things like the commitment committee, as well as brotherhood, and like I said, past president's council, he's very involved with that. Deborah Zimmer is really one of our amazing volunteers for so long. She's actually a paraclergy. She backs up the rabbi and the cantor and a lot of stuff. She is part of the Beit Din. She's very much so a greeter. And she's actually, for the community, is the mikvah chairperson. So these are two amazing human beings. And although we don't clap for them, maybe a little snappage for these two, they really deserve it. We continue on page 11 as they lead us in the lighting of our Yom Tov candles.
The first mitzvah in the Torah is, let there be light. So we are commanded, in everything you do, be a menorah, a bringer of light. Live with honor, act with integrity, do your work with passion, and the radiance of your deeds will live after you. May our ideals burn bright, forever unextinguished, and may we live our lives like the flames we kindle, always stretching upward, striving for the good, reaching for you.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu lahadlik ner shel yom tov. Source of blessing, eternal our God, you fill the universe with majestic might, teaching us holiness through sacred obligations, giving us the mitzvah of bringing light on this festival. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, shehechianu v'kiyamanu v'higianu lazman hazeh, source of blessing, eternal our God, you fill the universe with majestic might, giving us life, upholding the life within us, and bringing us to this time.
Baruch atah
Now that we've welcomed the Yom Tov candles, I invite you to welcome each other, wishing each other a good Yantiv. Take a moment, go ahead. All right, it's enough schmoozing for now. I'll give you another chance later, maybe, if you behave. We continue on page 15. Please rise if you're able.
Thank you.
the new moon, at the full moon, for a feast day, sound the shofar, for that is the law of Israel, the way of the God of Jacob. Hallelujah, betekau shofar, praise God with the blast of the shofar. Baruch atah Adonai, shomea kol truat, amo Yisrael berachamim. Blessed are you in our lives, Adonai. You hear with love the shofar, true voice of your prophet Israel.
Tekiya.
We continue on page 16. Here I am, one soul within this prayer community. Like those around me, I bring my own concerns and yearnings to this place, hoping they will find expression in the time-hallowed words of my people and in the traditions treasured, cherished by generations before me. May I bring the best of my energies to these holy days, approaching the spiritual work with open heart and mind, sincerity, and sustained focus on the deep questions of the season. Who am I? How shall I live? Where have I fallen short or failed? This night I take up the challenge of the days of awe, cheshbon ha-nefesh, a searching examination of my life, a moral inventory of my deeds, words, and thoughts. During the next 10 days, let me face the truth about myself and listen to your still, small voice. Taking comfort in your promise that I am always free to change, released from staleness and routine, let me know the joy of beginning again. May I gain strength as I share this task with those around me, united by our common purpose, tikkun midot, improving our characters, and tikkun olam, repairing the world. I now prepare myself to pray, one soul amidst this holy congregation.
Hineni he'ani mima'as, nireset v'nivcheret mipachad, yoshev tehilot Yisrael. Bati l'amor u'lechanen lefanecha, alamecha Yisrael asher. Shelachuni afal pi she'eni chedayid ve'aguna lechach al ken avakeshcha Elohe Avraham Elohe Yitzchak ve'Elohe צדיקים וחסידים התמימים והישרים ובעבור כבוד שמך הגדול והנורא כי אתה שומע תפילות עמך ישראל ברחמים
Page 19. Eloheinu v'Elohei avotenu v'imotenu, יהי רצון שנזכה לברכתך בשנת 5,778. Elohei Olam, our God and God of our ancestors, may we know your blessings, and in the year 5,778, Eternal One, bless us and the whole house of Israel with renewed life, happiness and peace, comfort and courage, resilience and strength. May the words of our heart be acceptable to you. In the new year that stretches before us, we are forever grateful for the gift of life. We continue with Baruch Hu on page 20.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Bidvaro Ma'ariv Aravim B'chokhma Poteach She'arim Uvivuna Meshane Itim U'machaliv Et Hazmanim U'msader Et HaKolchavim B'mishmeroteham Barakia Kirtzono Borei Yom V'Laila Galel Or Mipnei Choshech V'hoshech mipnei or, uma avir yom umevi laila, umavdil bain yom uvein laila, Adonai sebaot shmo. El chai vikayom, tamid yimuch alenu leolam ba'ed. Baruch ata Adonai hama arif arabi.
Bless Adonai, who spins dry day into dusk. With wisdom, watch the dawn gates open. With understanding, let the time and seasons come and go. With awe, perceive the stars in lawful orbit. Morning dawns, evening darkens. Darkness and yet light yielding. One to the other, yet each distinguished and unique. Marvel at life. Strive to know its ways. Seek wisdom and truth, the gateways to life's mysteries. Wondrous indeed in the evening twilight.
We continue on page 24. Mike, I think it's you.
Love beyond all space and time. Your love enfolds your people, Israel. We receive it in your teaching, your gift of Torah, sacred obligations, discipline, and law. So let us speak these teachings when we lie down and rise up and find joy forever in your Torah and mitzvot. They are the very essence of our life, ours to ponder and study all our days. May we never lose or be unworthy of your love. Baruch atah Adonai, Ohev Amo Yisrael, for you are blessed, the one who loves your people, Yisrael.
Please rise. We join together on the top of page 25. Shema Yisrael, hear the voice of Chana. There is no one holy as the Eternal. Truly there is none beside you. There is no rock like our God. Shema Yisrael, hear the call of Moses. Embrace and carry in your hearts this day. In heaven above, on earth below, Adonai is God, there is none else. Shema Yisrael, hear the words of the mystics. There is nothing but God. No place and no person is empty of God. The whole earth is suffused with God's glory. Hear, O Israel, God's hands are our hands. God's work is our work. God's voice speaks through us. God is one when we are one. Please be seated. We continue on pages 28 and page 30 with Ve'ahavta.
You shall love Adonai your God with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Set these words, which I command you this day, upon your heart. Teach them faithfully to your children. Speak of them in your home and on your way, when you lie down and when you rise up. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Let them be a symbol before your eyes. Inscribe them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Be mindful of all my mitzvot and do them. Thus you will become holy to your God. I, Adonai, am your God, who brought you out of Egypt to be your God. I am Adonai your God.
We continue responsively on page 33. To break the bonds of anger, to be generous of heart.
To break the bonds of shame, to live with self-respect.
To break the bonds of envy, to serve one another in joy.
To break the bonds of boredom, to be attentive to all God's purposes.
To break the bonds of fear, to live with courage and strength.
To untie the knots of betrayal, to love with fullness of being.
to break the bonds of loneliness, to receive a hand of hope.
To break the bonds of self-centeredness, to extend a hand of help.
Released from the darkness, our people found their freedom at the sea. We continue on page 34 with Micha Mocha. Turn to page 41, I have a question for you. The question is, do all tallitot have on the top the same thing? Do they all have the blessing on here? You know the answer already. The answer is no, right? Nod. Thank you. Well, actually, this one says, Dalifne mi ata omed, know before whom you stand, which is actually very common over an ark at synagogues. And I always love that quote because it helps me focus on what I do. So when I saw this next reading that I'm going to invite you now to read to yourself, you'll see that this is a very important part of what we're doing here. This is about us having our own relationship with whatever we call or however we define the divine. I invite you to read this personal prayer on page 41 to yourself. We continue with our tefillah on pages 42 and following. Please rise if you're able.
Adonai sefatai tiftah ufi agitei late. Elohim.
Baruch ata Adonai.
Baruch shema.
Magen Avraham bezrat Sarah. Shia morid hatal
You are holy, your name is holy. Seekers of holiness praise you day by day, Selah. Please be seated. We continue on page 54. In the middle of the page, Eloheinu v'Elohei Avotenu v'Imotenu, our God and God of the generations before us, may a memory of us ascend and come before you. May it be heard and seen by you, winning your favor and reaching your awareness. Together with the memory of our ancestors, the memory of your sacred city, Jerusalem, and the memory of your people, the family of Israel, may we be remembered for safety, well-being, and favor, for love and compassion, for life and for peace on this day of remembrance. Zochreinu Adonai Eloheinu bo letova. How about an amen there? Thank you. Ufokteinu bo livracha.
Amen.
Vehoshienu bo lechaim.
Amen.
Eternal our God, remember us.
Amen.
Be mindful of us.
Amen.
And redeem us for a life of goodness and blessing.
Amen.
We continue on page 60. We continue together on page 63, in the middle of the page. In the name of the daybreak and the eyelids of morning and the well-faring moon and the night when it departs, I swear I will not dishonor my soul with hatred, but offer myself humbly as a guardian of nature, as a healer of misery, as a messenger of wonder, as an architect of peace. In the name of the sun and its mirrors, and the day that embraces it, and the cloud veils drawn over it, and the utmost night, and the male and the female, and the plants bursting with seed, and the crowning seasons of the firefly and the apple, I will honor all life, wherever and in whatever form it may dwell, on earth my home, and in the mansions of the stars. Page 66. I invite you to either offer the prayer that is in your heart or feel free to do the reading on page 67. They're actually quite beautiful. Also, if you want to take a look on 69, you may find, just look at the title, you may find something that just kind of hits you right now as we take this time for silent reflection. We continue responsively on page 75. You'll read the indented parts. Ready? We can do this. We haven't forgotten Avinu Malkeinu.
Though we've overthrown kings and disobeyed fathers.
And we have no great liking for absolute power. Akiva stood before you in a time of drought, and his words went up like a flame on the altar.
Avinu Malkeinu, who alone are our ruler. Avinu Malkeinu, have compassion for us.
He was humble and forgiving, so his prayer was answered. Tonight we speak again in a time of drought, dry ground beneath us, no water, only rock.
Not a hunger for bread or a thirst for water, but hearts that are longing to hear God's voice.
For the sea of faith is all but gone, the tide's gone out on the empty beach. The world mocks our hopes and life tests our courage.
Why do the wicked live on and prosper? Why are you silent when they prey on the innocent?
And if your dominion is kindness and justice, why is creation in so much pain? Avinu Malkeinu, sustain our souls. Send rain to our roots. Help us find a way to pray.
Make us humble and forgiving of ourselves and one another.
Avinu Malkeinu, renew these words. Help us speak them with conviction and believe their truth. 100 generations have stood before the ark, and they lifted up their voices like flame on the altar. And they put their trust in kindness and justice, and they gave their strength to make the promise real.
Avinu Malkeinu, we have forgotten. Avinu Malkeinu, bring us back to you.
Please rise. We join together in the English, Avinu Malkeinu, almighty and merciful, you alone are our sovereign. Avinu Malkeinu, for your sake, show us mercy. Avinu Malkeinu, act toward us as befits your name. Avinu Malkeinu, bring healing and wholeness to the ill among us. Avinu Malkeinu, allay the harshness of the decree against us. Avinu Malkeinu, inscribe us in the book of redemption and renewal. Avinu Malkeinu, remember our goodness and call it to mind. Avinu Malkeinu, act for your sake and save us. Avinu Malkeinu, almighty and merciful, hear our voice. Avinu Malkeinu, we have strayed and sinned before you. Avinu Malkeinu, have compassion on us and our families. Avinu Malkeinu, halt the onslaught of sickness, violence, and hunger. Avinu Malkeinu, halt the reign of those who cause pain and terror. Avinu Malkeinu, enter our names in the book of lives well lived. Avinu Malkeinu, renew for us a year of goodness. Avinu Malkeinu, almighty and merciful, answer us with grace, for our deeds are wanting. Save us through acts of justice and love.
Oh, Avinu Malkeinu.
We need Rosh Hashanah. We may not have realized it. Maybe more than any other time, we really need Rosh Hashanah. With everything that is going on around us, the greater anger and divisiveness in our country, the tremendous force of nature that we have witnessed through hurricanes, flooding, and earthquakes, and that's just this last week, the sheer upset and even fear that some of us are feeling. My friends, we need Rosh Hashanah and the opportunity it provides us. Think about it. Rosh Hashanah demands that each of us, for the next few days, 10 to be exact, take the time to redirect our focus and our energy inward. Instead of keeping our eyes on the monitors and checking in on the latest natural disaster or horrific action taken by a leader, Rosh Hashanah offers us a wonderful alternative to social media. Rosh Hashanah invites us inward, not forgetting the world's issues, but affording us an opportunity to take a short break from them. Don't worry, they'll still be there later. We need this opportunity to reflect on our actions, on our lives, and what we choose to focus on going forward in the new year. We need this time to recharge our spiritual batteries, to take a breath mentally, to meditate and consider our physical health. We need these days to remind ourselves that people are mostly good, even if we could do better. So how do we recharge ourselves? We need to do the work of teshuvah, of turning. And with the way things are around us, maybe struggling a bit with our own ideas, opening ourselves up to hearing another point of view is exactly what we need to do. Instead of these 10 days of awe, they need to be the 10 days of searching, twisting, and turning. This is an opportunity to wrestle with our souls in the comfort of our Temple Emmanuel community as we attempt to find greater meaning to our existence and to better understand the challenges we face. What makes this time so important, though, is not the prayers, not the cool new prayer book that we're using for our third year, and it's very cool, not the lovely clothing or new haircuts. What makes it important is that we are here together. I would suggest that just showing up is what this is all about. We do not have to connect to all the prayers, all the words. We do not have to agree with the sermon, just wait. We don't have to like every piece of music. We don't have to necessarily even want it to have been here. What matters is that we are here, though, together. What matters is that we showed up, and together we are here to do this internal work in the sanctity of our holy community. As I'm sure you can understand, I've struggled this past month or two or three on what I might want to say these high holidays. I recognize that some of our congregation would love nothing more than for me to stay away from politics and anything controversial. I also understand that some of our congregation would love nothing more than for me to dive into politics and controversy. And yet, Don't we need a break from what is happening around us? We almost need like a spiritual cocoon, a place where we can be with our own thoughts without all the painful and hateful mishigas out there right now. And sadly, we must anticipate that this will be a very long year on many levels. So we really, really, really need Rosh Hashanah right now to help us prepare for our upcoming journey. By going through the process of Teshuvah over these 10 or so days, we are given the opportunity to slow our pace down, to become circumspect, and to let our personal needs take a higher percentage of our energy. Only by making the necessary changes these 10 days can we truly recharge our batteries while also readying ourselves for what is to come. In thinking about this year's High Holy Day sermons, I felt driven to go back to something I've done in the past, and that is to interweave through the sermons and in our programming year a theme. Some of those in the past were Torah, Tikkun Olam, Kesher, connection, Mishpacha, family, Israel, struggle, Tikva, hope. This year, we picked a theme during one of our senior staff meetings. In fact, during our brainstorming session, Barbara Smead, our early childhood educational director, summarized our discussion with one word, patience. I know, can you believe it? Our favorite thing, patience. I know, it's amazing. Well, we thought it'd be a terrific idea, hard to do, but a really good thing to think about right now in the midst of the most reactive and fast-paced time that many of us have ever lived in. Well, you know, patience is a virtue, right? Come on, how many of you were raised hearing that one? Patience is a virtue, yeah. As a child, I have to be honest with you, I really did not care for that expression. As an adult, I've gone through periods of time not even considering the true gift that patience can bring to a situation. But I was raised in a family, maybe some of you can relate, where there were not a lot of examples of patience offered by the adults. So new, what does a rabbi do when it comes time to prepare? Begin with our textual tradition, baby, because we study before we practice as Jews. What I found interesting is that our Tanakh, our Bible, has many words for patience, corresponding to the varied meanings of this very complex virtue. How about Orech Apayim, translated as long suffering? And we find this reference in Proverbs as it refers to the patience exhibited in the restraining of justifiable anger, not the time when you're in the car and the guy cuts you off. In the book of Ecclesiastes, we see the term Orech Ruach, which is translated as patient in spirit. This is in reference to the patience needed to go through our life cycle events. We also see in the Talmud the importance placed on patience. Ben Zoma uses Proverbs as his proof text, states, "He who is hard to provoke and easy to pacify takes first rank." Our scriptures place the highest mark of their approval on this restraint of anger by including it among the attributes of God. You can probably imagine the most emphasized use of patience in the Bible is the patience born of faith. According to our tradition, patience is the enduring of suffering and hardship without complaining and in silence with the assurance that God's salvation will be ultimately manifest to the faithful. This concept pervades the Psalms and many of the prophets. So the idea of Bubby suffering in the corner in the dark alone was virtuous. So too in the Talmud, we see the lesson of patience illustrated in the story of Rabbi Ada, who saw a woman wearing an inappropriate headdress and tore it off of her. He was fined 400 denarii, whereupon he quoted the popular adage, "Patience is worth 400 denarii." Let's just say it's all about considerateness in this particular piece. The great King Solomon urges the persistence of patience, for patience is not only an expression of faith, but of fortitude also, and there's so much more. In modern Hebrew, the word for patience is savlanut. The root for patience, for savlanut, is samech vet lamed, literally means to bear or to suffer. The virtue is to bear or suffer something unpleasant or painful without increasing the suffering. Maybe one of the great examples of savlanut is the suffering of Job, which is featured as the Haftarah on Yom Kippur afternoon, and I think is one of the highlights of Yom Kippur, which I highly recommend you come to the healing service and hear Dr. Dick Sog chant it. He does a great job. As a child, patience, though, feels like suffering, doesn't it? As adults, patience may be a virtue, even if it's still a bit painful. And there's so much to patience. Patience is knowing when to listen and when to act. Patience is actively listening to another. Patience is expressing ourselves reflectively and thoughtfully while also allowing another's opinion to be part of the conversation. Patience is about sitting with our thoughts and checking in with ourselves and asking, how do I feel? What did I do to contribute to this issue? Patience is making room for another without blaming, without judgment. I understand the idea of patience for many of us is downright meshuggah-making. We got things to do, people to see. Come on, my fellow A, type A personalities. We got to get to going, right? Isn't it about being first, winner take all? And if we don't move, the world around us will zip right on by. Isn't that how we function in the business world? There was a time when a company made sure its product was truly ready for release. Now it is about getting the new product out ASAP. If it doesn't work, don't worry, we'll send out a patch. I'll patch that over. And so many of our activities are about moving quickly. Snap, snap, we gotta get to it. Life is subject to time, and time goes way too quickly. What do you mean be patient? That is why I like baseball better than all the other team sports. I like a sport where you could stop to tie your shoe. We move so quickly, we forget what we are doing. We move so quickly, we may do what it takes to get it done, but are we doing it at our best? We move so quickly, we often forget to enjoy the moment and even the journey of getting there. And therein lies our challenge. If we move too quickly, we are missing a high percentage of our life experiences, or at the least, we are not getting the most of those powerful moments. Patience can be very virtuous, and I'm not so sure it comes easy to any of us. On Kol Nidre, we will talk about patience as a spiritual practice because being patient does take practice. And there is great benefits to being patient. But like I said, my friends, we need Rosh Hashanah. We need this opportunity to open ourselves up, to allow our natural vulnerability to go unprotected. And only through that true openness can we hear another person, as well as ourselves, our true selves. This is the time for us to take responsibility for what we have done and for the moments of impatience. Rosh Hashanah offers us an opportunity for patience. I know for me that the greatest sin during this past year has come out of impatience a high percentage of the time. And I'm sure some of you could relate. It is hard to be patient with another when they cannot see how their actions impact others. It is hard to be patient with another when they are mean and disrespectful. It is hard to be patient with another when they do not consider another's opinion. It is hard to be patient with another when they are not seeing what is clearly in front of them. And yet, the only appropriate reaction to savlanut, or the only appropriate reaction is savlanut, patience. If one is not ready to hear another or be self-reflective, that does not give one the right to be disrespectful. Go back to the car when the guy cuts you off. You know what I mean. When it comes down to it, patience is about making enough room for another. Patience is about opening our heart. Petach libi l'savlanut. Open my heart to patience. That should be our mantra every day this week. The holiest of work we can do right now is opening our heart to each other, beginning with ourselves, extending to our family, and then to our friends. May we petach lanu, open our hearts, for only when our hearts are open can we receive the blessings of relationship. When our hearts are open to another, we can never truly be alone. May we look at these holy days as an opportunity to bring in greater meaning, connection, and wholeness into our lives. May we open our hearts and minds to what our tradition gifted to us. May our patience open our hearts to receiving each other without judgment, upset, or negativity. Petach libi, open my heart to Torah, mitzvot, and our beautiful tradition. Amen.
Relax. It's only 17 pages. I had to say that. I'm sorry. Shana Tova. Welcome to Temple Emmanuel's High Holiday Services for 5778. I'm Andrew Weinberg, and it has been my honor to serve as president of your Temple Board of Trustees for the last 3.5 years. It's that time of year again, a time for taking stock of the last 12 months, for each of us to assess if we've come to where we should be. For me, in this role, it's maybe not quite so hard. So what have I been up to? Well, over the past year, I wrote 9 articles of my random ravings for our Connections newsletter. I've attended 87 Temple-related meetings, answered 139 emails, made or received 173 Temple-related phone calls, and attended 29 different Temple events, 17 of which included a meal of some sort. I met weekly with Rabbi Magad, except for holidays and vacations, for a total of 37 different times to discuss everything from Temple policy to national politics, membership strategy to leadership development, Temple past history and ideas for the future, all the way to the subplots and obscure movie scripts. I've told him 52 funny stories or jokes, to which he has laughed a total of 47 and a half times. Wait, the best is coming. How can someone laugh only halfway? Well, that particular time, I was certain he laughed, but he claims it was only a coincidental hiccup. So we agreed to call it half a laugh. And not to forget, I had one Temple member read me the riot act of one, about one particular subject, but then also insist on taking me out to lunch afterwards. So that's a Jewish disagreement. Seriously, maybe that's cute and all, but we're not really here to talk about whether Rabbi Magad finds me funny or not. The taking stock aspect, I think, is a major part of why many of us are here today. Personally, looking back almost a year, I can pinpoint when that started for me, but it's probably not what you think. It wasn't at 5:45 p.m. on Yom Kippur Day, looking longingly towards break the fast at 6 o'clock. Excuse me. Although those last few minutes of waiting for a fresh egg bagel, kugel, and chopped liver may be as trying a period in a Jewish person's life as any. No, for me, it was something that happened weeks later, almost a month after the high holidays. As many of you remember, last year we began a new approach where, for Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, we invited our most recently joined members to participate in the services. The response back then was overwhelmingly positive, and it seemed like a great move. A month later, the father of one of those families and I were talking, and he thanked me for the opportunity to be part of one service. It had meant a lot to him. Me, wearing my Temple membership hat at the time, replied that this was one great way for our newest members to connect with and feel part of the Temple community. He agreed, but he explained it was also much more than that to him. In his eyes, that opportunity to stand up and make a contribution in front of the congregation and his family, including his young sons, was a way to set an example. And he couldn't have been more right, but he had no idea how much so. Those words were a foreshadowing of events for yet to come for me in the months ahead. Let me just add that from my perspective, the year that passed after that conversation was anything but ordinary. This was the year that my daughter became a bat mitzvah, thank you very much, and an event that is, of course, a major milestone in the life of any Jewish person. My wife was consumed with the details of the planning, with, of course, my minimal contributions, as is, I suppose, typical, sorry. But we were happy to be included in several of the other B'nai Mitzvah events of my daughter's class. Each young person, in their own way, on their own day, was taking that pivotal step towards Jewish adulthood. Although the students were, of course, the main focus of the day, I began to also pay attention to the parents, trying to grasp what they had brought to the table to make these special days possible. This class and many of these students had been together for the most part since the preschool years. Their motivation to make this big effort, this big commitment, seems to have come in part from support of their families, part from the camaraderie of their classmates, but certainly also for being part of a Jewish community. But a family becoming part of a Jewish community is not necessarily a given. It's a major decision to join and stay connected. Those religious school carpools don't really happen on their own. There's the financial aspect, and of course, each year you have to struggle to stay awake during the president's speech, right? But all of these families found it was the right thing to do and became part of a Jewish community. The common theme I found was the parents' underlying message,
among all of the other opportunities and activities open to us as a family, being part of a Jewish community is important, and we will do it together. And there it was, plain as day, the parents were setting an example. I continued pondering this on and off over the next five or six B'nai Mitzvahs, and something else caught my attention. Rabbi Magad always has a special individual speech for each of the B'nai Mitzvah student or the B'nai Mitzvah student of the day, but one part is always common. That bit has to do with the student, after demonstrating this major commitment, being welcomed back into the religious school as a madrich or madricha, a teacher's aide in a younger class. Our most recent B'nai Mitzvah graduates would help the younger students understand the importance of a Jewish community, and by doing so, set an example. And from here, these young people will go forward in life, understanding that they have a community responsibility beyond themselves, just as their parents understood before them. The cycle continues. So at what must have been my fourth House of Bagels B'nai Mitzvah lunch, I came to something of a conclusion. For all of us as Jews, one of our most basic responsibilities is pretty simple. In our own way, each of us has to make a positive impact on the community. Doing something, anything, makes our community stronger, but also sets an example for others just finding their way. In a most basic sense, all of us, just by being here on this day as part of Temple Emmanuel, are setting an example for ourselves, our families, and our temple friends that our community and heritage are important. How about that? All this from a casual comment one morning in front of the religious school. Well, a new year is upon us, and with it, new opportunities for making a difference in the Temple Emmanuel community, each in our own way. Volunteer your time, share your ideas, join a committee or work on a project, or you know, even just make a habit of striking up a conversation with somebody new at services or events. The possibilities are limited only by your imagination. Temple Emmanuel is here for each of us to set an example, and its only true limitations are financial. Our annual campaign that begins today goes a long way towards helping bring many of these new ideas, projects, and even dreams, large and small, to reality. It was my honor to make the first donation this year, and I hope you'll join me in a way that is significant to you. All support is appreciated, and pledge cards are included in your service programs. On behalf of the Temple Board and staff, I wish you and your families a new year of health and happiness. Thank you all for being part of the Temple Emmanuel community, and again, Shana Tova.
Good evening, Shana Tova. I'll just let you know that my speech is definitely the shortest out of anyone's this evening. My name is Alyssa Meltzer, and it's my honor to represent the Board of Trustees this evening. I'm very happy to see all of you and to be sharing the High Holy Days observance with you and those live streaming our services on our Facebook page and our website. I want to take this opportunity to wish you and your families a very happy new year, one filled with good health and peace. We want to express our thanks to Yuri Gottfeld and the Brotherhood members and friends for creating the Bima you see before you. Each year they work hard to develop a synagogue-like atmosphere where we can worship together appropriately. Also to our many hardworking volunteers and the temple administrative and custodial staffs for their preparations for services this year, and of course to our clergy for leading us through beautiful services this year. We appreciate your flexibility in sharing prayer books. If you are using a temple book, please leave it on the table as you leave the sanctuary. If you brought your own, please be sure to take it with you. Our Rosh Hashanah children's service will begin at 9 a.m. tomorrow, and our congregational service will start at 10 a.m. We look forward to seeing you there. Please join us for Tashlik service and picnic tomorrow, September 21st at 5 p.m. at Oak Meadow Park in Los Gatos. Please bring dinner for yourself and a dessert to share with others. For details and directions, please pick up a flyer from the Shalom table. Wednesday, October 4th is Erev Sukkot. We invite you to bring dinner for your family, a dessert to share, and your artistic flair as we will decorate our Sukkah. Our Sukkot experience will begin at 4:30 p.m. Join Rabbi Magat on an upcoming trip to Israel this summer on Sunday, October 8th, At 12:30 p.m., there will be an informational meeting about the trips he will be leading in the summer of 2018, designed for first-timers, families, and returnees. If you have children participating in tomorrow's child care program, please note that this program will take place in the Mary Campbell Room beginning at 10 a.m. During the High Holy Days, we are collecting non-perishable packaged food for the needy in our community. Please deposit your food donations in one of our collection barrels located in the lobby here or at Temple Emmanuel through Simchat Torah. And finally, please take a piece of honey cake as you leave tonight's service. Shana Tova, and may this year bring you happiness and joy.
On a microphone. Sorry about that. We also want to take this opportunity to thank our amazing choir, our musicians, for doing such a great, great job. Thank you all so much for contributing, and we've just begun. Yes. Nice. Very nice.
Page 79.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher bachar banu mikol haolam Veromemanu mikol lashon Vekidshanu b'mitzvotav Vatiten lanu Adonai Eloheinu be'ahava Kadesh Israel V'yom HaZikaron Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Shehechiyanu V'kimu
what I do for pregnant cantors. That was delicious. Thank you. We continue with Elena on page 83. Please rise if you're able.
Shabeach ladon hakol latet yirula liotzer breshit shehu note shamayim veyoser aretz umoshev yikaro bashamayim mimal ushchinatu zo begovei meromim
We continue on page 89, the life of eternity. The light of life is a finite flame. Like our sacred candles, life is kindled, it burns, it glows, it is radiant with warmth and beauty, but soon it fades, its substance is consumed, and it is no more. In light we see, in light we are seen. The flames dance and our lives are full. But as night follows day, the candle of our life burns down and gutters. There's an end to the flames. We see no more and are no more seen. Yet we do not despair. For we are more than a memory slowly fading into the darkness. With our lives we give life. Something of us can never die. We move in the eternal cycle of darkness and death, of light and life. On page 90, we'll continue with our Mourner's Kaddish. I just want to remind you before we stand up, if you take a look, you'll see there's two added words that are in kind of gray bolded right in the middle. And you'll see it says, Ul Ela Mikol. They just add those two words there. So I invite you to please rise as we think about all those members of our family, our community who've died recently or in years past. We also think of those that have lost their lives due to natural disasters and acts of violence and hate. As we join together, thinking of our loved ones tenderly, Yitkadal v'yitkadash shmei rabba, be'alma divra chirutei v'yamlich malachutei, v'chayechon v'yomechon, v'chaye d'chol beit Yisrael, v'agala v'uzman kari v'imru amen. Yehe shmei rabba mivorach le'olam olmei alamaya, yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitpa'ar v'tchumam v'yitnaseh, V'yitadar v'italei v'italal shmei d'kudesha b'richu le'alam ul'eila mikol birchata v'shirata tushpechata v'nechemata da'amiran b'alma v'imru amen. Yehe shlomo rabba mishamaya v'chayim aleinu v'akol Yisrael v'imru amen. Ose shalom b'mromav hu yase shalom aleinu v'akol Yisrael V'kol yoshvei tevel ve'imru. Amen. Please be seated.
Continue on page 96, singing Yigdal. We'll be doing verses 1, 2, and 7.
Yigdal Elohim Chai v'yishtabach Nimza ve'enit el mitziuto
Yehra ve'enavid ne'yidata Yehra ve'enav ezom le'avduto
Ein lo demut
Continue on page 98. We join together. Our God and God of all generations before us, may it be your will in the coming year to grant us a year of abundance and atonement. Your turn.
A year of blessings to serve and receive.
A year of community and compassion.
A year of light and exaltation.
A year of enlightenment.
A year of friendship and forgiveness.
A year of going up in gladness to the land of Israel.
A year of health.
A year of inner strength and well-being.
A year of joy and Jewish celebration.
A year of knowledge and learning for its own sake.
A year of love between parents and children, friends and spouses, brothers and sisters.
A year of mitzvot and moments of sweetness.
A year of nature protected and enjoyed.
A year of optimism and hope.
A year of peace pursued with perseverance.
A year of quiet and tranquility.
A year of rain in its season.
A year of song and spiritual growth.
A year of Torah study and tikkun olam.
A year of understanding and unity.
A year of vows fulfilled and the blessings overcome.
A year of wisdom acquired and shared.
A year of coexistence among the families of the earth.
A year of young and old reaching out to one another.
A year of Zion and glow with the light for us in all the world.
And repeat after me, we're going to add one more, a year of patience.
A year of patience.
Or maybe a year of greater patience, I guess. Our God and God of the generations before us, grant us a year of gratitude to you for the most profound of blessings, your gift of life. Yehi ratzon milfanecha, Adonai Eloheinu ve'Elohei Avoteinu v'Imoteinu, shetchadesh aleinu shana tova u'metuka. Our God and God of all our ancestors, eternal God of all generations, may your presence in our lives this new year renew our spirits and renew our strength. May it be a good year, may it be a sweet year. Amen. Shana tova u'metuka, may be a sweet, healthy, and happy year for all of us. Amen. We'll see you tomorrow morning. Drive safely.